I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome to Conversations with Al McFarlane, broadcasting from the Marcus Garvey House here in North Minneapolis. And you know, it's all about the neighborhood. This is a conversation about how we build our community, our neighborhood, house by house, family by family. We're focusing on business creation, business development, economic development, and culture. It's a wonderful conversation, a robust conversation. One of the guides for this conversation is my brother, who takes us on a musical journey, Wayne McFarlane and jazz. Check him out.
Be up, be down, be clean, be messy, be here, be wherever, be sour, be sweet, be the rhythm, be the beat, be funny, be serious, be in, be out. Wherever you're at in life, be you. With Medica, you belong.
Programming is supported by UCare, where health coverage, personal service, and quality care come together to put members first. Learn more at ucare.org. UCare. Healthcare that starts with you.
I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome to Conversations with Al McFarlane, broadcasting today from the Marcus Garvey House in North Minneapolis. I'm glad to have Mike Temali. He's the leading light, the CEO, the guru for business development for NDC, Neighborhood Development Center in St. Paul. And Mike, thank you for being here. I want to talk about the question of how do we get to bringing more Black, African American people into the business arena? What do you think?
Well, first of all, thank you for having me. I appreciate that very much. So my thought is that it's got to be a long and steady vision. It's got to start here and now with what we already do and what we already know how to do, which is pretty substantial. There are hundreds of African-American-owned businesses in Minneapolis and in St. Paul. There are a number of organizations that work with them. There's a lot of knowledge that's been built up over the decades, a lot of role models. Mm-hmm. There's, as you know very well, there's African-American owners of franchises, of large companies, small companies, startup companies, home-based companies, everybody. And so the role models are there, the know-how is there. I think it's got to be a real long-term commitment to spreading that that kind of a entrepreneurial culture, you might call it, throughout the entire breadth and width of the African-American community, starting with children and all the way to seniors, because plenty of businesses are started by seniors. There are businesses started by kids. There's programs for kids in the schools. And that whole, you know, from cradle to grave, basically, there are things that work and that are necessary for to open up people's minds about this as an alternative option that is not just for other people, but is also for every African-American person who's interested in it.
I want to talk about the philosophy of identity, the philosophy of entrepreneurship, of commerce, the presence of that or the lack thereof as you see it in the African American community, number one. But before that, let me have our viewers get NDC 101. Tell us, who is NDC, what do you do, and how do you do it?
Okay, thanks. So the Neighborhood Development Center started in 1993, basically in the auspices of Western Bank over at University in Dale in St. Paul. Bill Sands was sort of the created a platform for this to rise up. It really rose up from the community, and it started from an understanding that there are maybe a lack of businesses on Selby Avenue, a lack of businesses even on University Avenue or West Broadway, but There are literally thousands of people in each of these communities that run a business out of their back door. Mm-hmm. Legitimate business other than they're kind of underground, you might say. It's called the informal economy.
Right.
And there are thousands and thousands of people like that in every community, including low income, including African American. Mm-hmm. And they do everything from hair to cooking to taking care of kids to fixing cars to carpentry, whatever it could be. And mm-hmm. you know, in the old days, we called it earning some beer money or egg money or whatever. Everybody did that, right?
Yeah, yeah.
That's the vein of entrepreneurship that we learned about in the early 90s, coming out of some studies in Summit University. Greg Finzel, who you probably know, District 8 Planning Council, partnered with the University of Minnesota, did a real substantive study of Summit University residents and found that 15% of them ran a business out of their back door. And yet, Selby Avenue was empty. So our idea back then was to say, how do we reach that 15%, those hundreds and hundreds of people that already live in that neighborhood, that like that neighborhood, that aren't negative about that neighborhood, and get them dialed into a set of resources and services and programs that can elevate their entrepreneurial idea and skill into a formal business and bring them out to the avenue. And that's what we started then. We partnered with two community groups to be the outreach. So one was Aurora St. Anthony, neighborhood corporation with Ron Pauline then, Naida Presley now, and the other was Selby Area CDC. And they did the outreach, and they collected probably 20 interested people each that were from their neighborhood that wanted to start a business and were interested in taking our business plan class. And so in that year, 93, we started a training class in both Aurora St. Anthony's office and Selby CDC's office and provided 10 sessions on how to write a business plan for your own business idea. Everybody in that setting was from that particular neighborhood. They knew each other. So right away, you have a peer group.
Mm-hmm.
They're under the auspices of Ron Pauline or Stacy Millett, I think was over at Selby CDC at the time. And, you know, so there was comfort. There's a whole set of misconceptions about entrepreneurship that prevent people from even exploring it seriously, like my credit's lousy or whatever. We designed this training class out in the neighborhoods to get past that. You talk about accessibility to capital or accessibility to the economy. A big part is getting past people's own personal fears. And so we have 10 people in these classes. We started in two neighborhoods. We've now trained over 5,000 people. 85% are persons of color. And 40% are African American that we've trained. Almost 2,000 African Americans have gone through our 20-week class now. 10 class sessions in your little group, and then 10 one-on-ones. Mm-hmm. After they come out of the training class with your business plan, we then do lending. Mm-hmm. So we do financing, and we put out about $12 million onto the street. A lot of it, most of it's been what they call micro loans.
Mm-hmm.
So $5,000, $10,000, $20,000 loans. And again, 40% or so of that has been to African-American-owned businesses. And once they're in business, we provide technical assistance. So that's everything from legal to graphic design, social media, accounting, of course, always accounting. So we have trained about 5,000 people, very low income primarily, in neighborhoods around Minneapolis and St. Paul. We have financed, I think, 500 or 600 of them.
Mm-hmm.
And today we have approximately 500 businesses open, of which over 200 are African American owned. The last big thing we do is we build business incubators, we call them, but the rest of the world knows these projects as something different. So the Midtown Global Market in the old Sears building on Lake in Chicago is a project we've done with some partner organizations, including the Cultural Wellness Center.
Mm-hmm.
And to this day, we own and operate that project with them. And most of the people in there have been trained and financed by our program.
It's a great program, great project.
You've been there many times.
Many times.
Broadcasting.
We've done this program.
I know you have.
Yeah,
I've seen that.
The Mercado Central down the street from their lake in Bloomington, similar with Project for Pride and Living and the cooperative of tenants in there. We own and operate that. And in University in Dale, St. Paul, Frogtown Square, is a new project we did with Model Cities, Beverly Hawkins, and Naida of Arderos and Anthony. So we do this real estate development in order to house these entrepreneurs. The idea is these key corners of these targeted neighborhoods ought to be essentially owned by and occupied by folks from the neighborhood. And no better way to do that than having folks that come through this pipeline land right in front of their own neighborhood where thousands of cars every day go by. Mm-hmm. It puts an image onto the neighborhood. It gives a positive feeling to the community that comes from within, not from someone else coming in from outside and putting a little franchise or something there.
Right. And so you've mentioned this great success stories in South Minneapolis and Frogtown, Summit University in St. Paul. You got a facility, NDC branch here in North Minneapolis, correct?
No.
You don't? I thought you had a partner in North Minneapolis.
We have a partner,
that's
not
what
a facility.
It is, not a facility. But what could happen along the lines of what's happened in St. Paul in North Minneapolis? Question number one. The bigger question is, how do we take the successes that you have experienced and created to scale? What does that mean? How do we have that knowledge, that experience, be elevated so that it has a dramatic an immediate return of economic vitality, jobs, business creation in our community. I think, for example, that when we had the big recession at the beginning of President Obama's first term, our country channeled massive resources into saving the banking industry.
Sure did.
How do we get our country to think about channeling massive resources into elevating and growing the economic vitality of communities of color of inner cities? Is that a doable thought?
It's absolutely doable. And you know what you're doing in the media here is a very key part of that, because so much of our problems in our society come from misinformation and from misunderstanding and from lack of connection. Mm-hmm. So, you know, frankly, one of our goals at the Midtown Global Market on Lake in Chicago was to have all the different cultures interact with each other, because, to be honest, the Mercado Central down the street is pretty heavily Latino selling to Latinos, which is good, and that elevated, I think, the image of what Latinos bring to our city. Mm-hmm. I think the Global Market does that, plus gives a lot of cross-cultural experience. But I think that, I mean, our strategy and my personal philosophy is that you need these successes to be visible out on key corridors or where there's a lot of traffic, mm-hmm. Which is sort of the physical version of the media, mm-hmm. And that these successes need to multiply steadily. It's not going to be instantly, but it needs to be steady. So you take a Golden Time Coffee Shop at Selby and Milton in St. Paul. You know, what does that mean to the community is profound. I mean, Michael and his wife have been in there for now 15 years, I believe, maybe 20. They came through our training class.
Yep. We've done our broadcast from there as well.
Yeah. I have no doubt. And you know, what that tells both the African-American community, young and old, as well as the broader community, is profound and positive. Now, if you multiplied that, both by having the media lifted up more, but also having more golden times and more, here I have a list of 206 African-American-owned businesses that we've worked with. You multiply them on a faster pace, by the training, by the outreach, by the, you know, the financing, and none of this is easy, particularly for each entrepreneur. I mean, one thing we should be clear about is being an entrepreneur is 100 hours a week, huge risk, huge headache, and you're pretty much going to be more broke before than after you started for a number of years, unless you're real unusual. So it's not for everybody, but if you can concentrate In this example, North Minneapolis, West Broadway, African-American-owned businesses out on West Broadway, and there's 5 or 10 more every year happening, people begin to create an expectation, oh, this is a place that's happening. So you have to deal with the business development, that's able to do this, but also the real estate side. Mm-hmm. Because if these folks are scattered to the four corners of the earth, it doesn't resonate the same way. It doesn't have as many ripple effects, in my opinion.
Concentration makes a difference.
I think so, the visible concentration. We call it concentrated poverty needs concentrated opportunity.
Okay.
Because we're, and our model, by the way, has been replicated in Detroit, Michigan now for about 4 years, mm-hmm. and is about to be replicated in Philadelphia, New Orleans, Albuquerque, and Syracuse. So we're making some inroads nationally where groups get that this is a long slog, but if you're not deliberate about it and if you're not passionate about it, it isn't going to happen ever.
Mike Temali, you are a McAllister College philosophy major. How did you come to this work?
You know, my parents immigrated 2 years before I was born. They were refugees after the World War II in Europe. Mm-hmm. Came out of a refugee camp and landed in this country without speaking English, without any money, making nuts and bolts and washers in Youngstown, Ohio, in Stanley Works. Eventually, my dad, my mom learned English. My dad went into youth work, and we lived in the old neighborhood house on the west side of St. Paul. That's we lived in, under the attic. And he ran their Camp of Wendigo, and he ran their youth work. And then he went on from that to start the St. Paul Big Brother program, and I grew up on the east side of St. Paul. So I guess I'm an odd duck in that I come out of a blue-collar neighborhood, the east side, pretty much. But my parent, I don't have any relatives in this country. They're all in Yugoslavia or Denmark. So I learned right away about multiculture. My mother's Danish, my dad's Yugoslav. So, you know, different cultures were part of my bones and blood and daily life. As were, I'd say, old school blue collar values coming out of the east side. You know, immigrants were always part of that. I worked for summer camps for 9 years for Martin Luther King Center, MLK, or Hallecky Brown, Big Brothers. My whole life has been in kind of the neighbor, what other people call the inner city of St. Paul. And plus, I love what small business brings to a society. I think, you know, as opposed to large corporations, which have their role, mm-hmm. Small business brings so much culture, so much personality, so much innovation, and fills in the all the blanks in a street like Broadway or University Avenue. I like the mix. I like how all these different cultures and personalities and ideas come together in a small business. It's just very invigorating for me.
I'm Al McFarlane. This is Conversations with Al McFarlane. My guest, Mike Temali, he's the president of Neighborhood Development Center in St. Paul. I'm going to continue the conversation in a minute. I'll have two other people join us who are partnering with NDC, Neighborhood Development Centers, to create robust activity, forward movement in the area of business creation. Stay tuned. I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome back to Conversations with Al McFarlane. Continue with this important discussion on business development in our community, access to capital. Mike Temali, one of the things I hear most often is that access to capital is a problem for small businesses, for black businesses. Is that the only answer? Is it capital plus?
It's definitely capital plus. And I'm glad you asked, because the access is an interesting word if you focus on the word access. Everybody focuses on the word capital, and so we need $50 million, $100 million, and that's true. We need more money dedicated to financing neighborhood businesses, African-American businesses, that's for sure. But the word access means how do you responsibly set people, get people into a business where they can be successful enough to feed their family, to pay all their bills, including your loan back. And the key on all of that is training and technical assistance. And so the model we have at NDC, and it's not unique to us, is a combination of entrepreneur training and technical assistance that goes in with the financing. Because, you know, if a person can walk into a bank and come away with a $100,000 loan, God bless them, and they can go do that. But very few people can do that, particularly with a startup business. In particular, if you maybe have a little rough credit history, or you haven't owned a business before or managed a business. So the training and technical assistance, where I'm talking about everything from creating a really strong business plan and management plan, operations plan, but then also having legal help at your side, having accounting help at your side, having contractor backroom help at your side, and marketing help. And initially, pardon me, initially that needs to be provided not just quickly and professionally, but also at either no cost or a very subsidized cost for people that are just starting out because they don't have any money. And so that's what we've done with hundreds of businesses at NDC, or thousands actually. And MEDA does that kind of work. And other organizations here in town and nationally do that. But all of us are highly constrained by our lack of funding because it's high touch to go with some high risk. Our loan portfolio, by the way, we've lent $12 million out. We get 95% of that repaid. Okay. And it's 100% people that are not bankable. Initially.
And they pay the money back.
And they pay the money back. Yeah. And this is true nationally as well. But it is because of the additional resources that we can bring to bear.
The history in the past quite often, and I think might have characterized the early days of organizations like MEDA, even SBA, there was almost an expectation that investments made in minority businesses would not be investments that found a return, that people wouldn't pay money back. And people cynically would say, if I give money to minority businesses, I'm pouring money down a rat hole because it's not going to come back. And that excused them from doing business with developing and emerging businesses. Have you heard that?
Well, I haven't, and I think it's because people know better than to say that to me. I find that very offensive. You know, we have had equally strong outcomes and loan repayments and business success and job creation from the African-American, the 40% of entrepreneurs we've worked with who are African-American, as we do with the 40% who are recent immigrant, 5% Native American, 15% white. We don't get any significant difference in outcomes, including loan repayment. So it's really, I keep going back to the word access. What does it take for, it's a two-way street to get people that have been excluded from the system for decades and throughout their personal entire life to feel like this is an opportunity for them. And so our, you know, connecting with these folks through neighborhood partners, through groups like Silas's and many others is mandatory for them to even come in the door. And then we have to have staff that are multicultural, that are highly trained to work in different, or that come from these communities. There needs to be a comfort because these are difficult issues. Why is someone's credit lousy? Well, no one wants to talk about that. It's painful. There's pain involved in their personal life. And so for them even to address something like that, you need to spend time and develop a connection and trust, and that's what it takes. You can't just throw loan money out the door and expect this to work.
Let me introduce Silas Houston. He's the principal at the Metro Area Small Contractors Association. They call it MASCA. And his colleague, attorney, Keillan Curtis. Keillan's my attorney as well. Keillan, good to see you again. And thank both of you brothers, gentlemen, for being here and joining the conversation. And Silas and Keillan, what you are doing is creating kind of a grassroots, self-organizing experience that tries to mobilize opportunity for a specialized area of business that small contractors. Give me the 30-second description, Silas, of what MASCA is and what it's doing. And I say 30 seconds because I know you, like Mike, can talk about an hour on this, so I'm conditioning this response.
Take your time.
Right, I'll keep it short. Well, first, I'd like to say it's MASCA, Metro Area Small Contractors Alliance. And that last word is the most critical for us because that's what MASCA is. We are an alliance of contractors. We're an alliance of professionals. We're an alliance of organizations that exist within the community, such as NDC and MEDA. And our whole motto is designed around shared resources, around going into the marketplace at a collective, and then through that collective, increasing our volume so that we can get a better set of operational controls so that we're less risky and thus we can get larger projects, larger loans, and larger staff and grow our employment base. So that's the 30-second version.
Keillan, jump in if you would. And so the philosophy guiding this, I know you've talked to me about your belief that we can do for ourselves. Yes. As African Americans, so explore that idea.
Yeah, certainly. I think very often we don't think in terms of being responsible capitalists. Very often we think in terms of simply giving to each other and being separated from others who are professionals. And I think our philosophy is saying let's blend those of us who are professionals along with those of us who are workers, along with those of us who are in the nonprofit side. And so for me, my primary job is being an attorney. But doesn't mean that I don't give out pro bono hours. Doesn't mean that I don't help someone initially who's starting out a business, knowing that I'll get a return in the future. And I think MASCA has the same philosophy, that they're going to be people who are at a certain level who can help us pay the fees, invest in us. Then there are other people that we're going to help along, knowing that we'll have that development later that will be an institution for the community also.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so barriers to our businesses being successful and growing. I mentioned the question to Mike, is it capital or capital plus? What's your answer to that, Silas?
It's definitely capital plus. What you find is that if the plus doesn't happen, the capital is never coming. And that's where it's more plus capital, right? Mm-hmm. And it's not capital plus because no one is gonna loan you $1 million if you can't produce an audit, if you don't have an audit trail, if you don't have, right? And so no one is gonna loan you money for $1 million project if they don't know that the cost part of that is appropriately counted for, that there's really a profit, that you can actually get these materials, that you can perform this job. And so the capital becomes a aspect of risk and perceived risk. And when you start off being perceived as being more risky, and then when you show up, your profile says, yes, in fact, I am more risky, then your skill set, your ability to perform all gets lost because we're now going through this, right? Can you produce this? Can you give me that? Do you have this information? Which is understandable from the lending community perspective. And that's the reason why organizations such as NDC are so critical, because you can't wish yourself to a different spot. So you only can start where you're at. And so when you're able to go to organizations such as that, have them give you some resources so that you can prove your track record and move along, and then you're able to begin to access capital as you need. The area of capital that we are lacking in the most is not really lending as much as it is general investment. I mean, not everybody gets their money from going to a bank. Some people get equity investments in and people sharing in the risk of them growing and developing their business. And those are the people that fund losses while you're developing your business, not the bank.
What do you mean by that?
Well,
we say not everybody goes to a bank for equity, where do people get equity from?
Well, when the banks give you loans, so they're giving you debt. When you say equity, you're saying somebody that's willing to invest, buy a share in your business and say, okay, I believe in what you're doing and I'm going to wait to get a return on my money until sometime later. I understand that you're trying to capitalize to get to another level, may want to build a building or open a plant. And then instead of going to a bank, the investors buy stocks, which then allows me to go and to make that next step of development. When we as African Americans are coming to the table, we come to the table with very little equity investments. We're highly leveraged, and highly leveraged just makes you more risky. Which
how do we change that? How do we address that?
I think we need to look within ourselves and look to the African American community of investors. Ask why do they not have confidence in us? Build confidence. That's what MASCA is all about, is trying to do things in a way that we can build confidence in the average investor so that ultimately they will be our major source of capital as we grow.
So I kind of call this creating a mechanism for skin in the game for our community. And I want you to respond, Keillan, because this, in a sense, expands on what you're saying, us working with each other,
yeah,
finding a way to be comfortable and to have experiences that justify our continued cooperation and collaboration. How do we build that in the business sense? I think you're saying you're doing that as professionals, working together to promote individuals, but how do you expand that?
Well, I think there's a lot of different examples out there from crowdfunding and things like that, where people directly invest in specific projects and they get a return on their money. I think within the African American community, I think it starts with the professionals educating some of the people about what the return looks like, how long it takes, saying, hey, there may be an alternative. Because for many of us, we invest in the stock market, you know, our 401ks, but we never think there may be this alternative. And so with some of my clients who come from other countries, when I see their investing model, very often it's, I'm going to my family, we're gonna write up this agreement, here's what you own. Then they go out to their friends, say, hey, we're gonna invest more, plus you're gonna bring us clients and customers, and here's how you're gonna get your money back. And so for me, when I see a lot of immigrants who may not have a college degree, let alone a PhD or JD, and they're figuring these things out, it seems so simple for us, and the question becomes, how do we build that trust?
And I think so it's— what's the problem with this? Why don't we see it, and why don't we do it?
I think part of it is, we do it to a limited extent, and very often it's only among professionals do we invest with each other. And of that, it's even more limited about who we're willing to invest in. And so I think it takes people like a mass and say, hey, we have the infrastructure going. Here's how you can invest at $5, $100, $1,000. I think it takes people promoting, such as yourself, in media saying, why aren't we investing together? Why don't we own the community convenience store that we all shop at? Why don't we own the car wash that we go to? Why don't we own the gas station? And then we get together, we put the paperwork together so everyone can read it and understand it's not a fly-by-night thing. And then we all check our egos and say, we don't want our money back for a year. Understand this is an investment. So you're not going to get your money back for 30 days, 60 days. It's going to be a year. And it's something that you're going to leave to your children.
How's that sound to you, Mike?
It sounds real good. I think, you know, a lot of thoughts have been put on the table here. The crowdsourcing has kind of taken— I've always been amazed that anybody would put a nickel into one of those things, and they do. So,
and those, working now. It's
sure is, and I don't think those folks ever get their money back.
They
get a T-shirt or a cup of coffee or a beer or whatever. So I think there are a lot of models, but it does occur to me that, you know, when we talk about access to capital and the governor has proposed a new special session, potentially a $15 million investment and so on, I have never heard anybody talk about creating an equity fund in that context. Now, that's a different direction than you were going, which is how do we do it ourselves, which I think is a much better idea long term. But it also occurs to me that when you talk about disparities, wealth is one of the worst disparities between black and white,
and income.
Yeah, so I think, you know, there's probably a need for some initial seed money coming into that kind of an idea, the equity that you were talking about, that maybe it's a combination of from within the community, but augmented by something the governor's talking about or foundations or whatever. But that does certainly help the prognosis of any business is to have equity in addition to debt.
Silas, so what's your expectation? You've got a model that you're working to grow. You've got, I think, a number of colleagues, partners, business owners that have come together and created and become the Alliance, and you're actually doing work now. You're proving a model, correct?
Correct.
What's the vision? What's the strategy?
The strategy really for us is just to partner with organizations such as NDC and MITA, who are the easy lenders, easy financer, but also have a joint mission in what we're trying to do in terms of community development.
Not and, easy because they're easy.
But I mean easy in terms of easier than going to other funding sources to get the money because they have a common mission to us, which makes them putting their resources in an easier proposition. Is what we mean by easier. Ultimately, our goal is to leverage that alliance with philanthropic investment, with investment from the community, to make our base right within the community, to support the contractors, to grow within the community, but ultimately to do projects within the community. We believe that the nonprofit development community that is doing hundreds of houses spread out all across the city are the natural partners for our model because they're committed to the community, hiring from within the community, and that's exactly what we can provide them. When that alignment comes together, then it allows everybody in it to get something out of it as they're putting something into it. And it creates an environment where a young person looking for a job can have confidence, not only that I'm gonna get one, but I can keep one and that I can grow within that job and it becomes a career. And that's what our model is really designed around. And that's what our goals are.
In your group, as your name indicates, a small contractor. So what kinds of work are your partners doing?
Our contractors, they are painters, they are electricians, they do flooring, they do concrete and masonry, they do, what am I missing?
Drywall
and sheetrock, they roofing, a variety of different services that they do. MASCA is constantly, attracting new contractors with different skills to the model as well.
I'm Al McFarlane. This is Conversations with Al McFarlane. My guest, Silas Houston, leader of Metro Area Small Contractors Association, his colleague, Keillan Curtis, attorney Keillan Curtis, and one of the principals at MASCA, and Mike Temali of Neighborhood Development Centers. We call it NDC. Stay tuned. We'll be back. I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome back to Conversations with Al McFarlane, broadcasting from the Marcus Garvey House in North Minneapolis. This is a great conversation, and it's about all of us understanding and creating a dialogue around business creation, around entrepreneurship. I've often said that as a communicator, I believe my goal and my desire is to help our people recast our image. How do we begin to identify ourselves as entrepreneurial people? I would love it if when somebody who showed up from anywhere they could have showed up from looks out my front door and sees a guy walking down the street and says, oh, those guys are business people. How do you create that kind of identity? And so I think this conversation moves us in that direction. Mike, you say there is huge talent in every community, and that includes the African American Black community. The problem is that in the past, somehow, both the general market and too often our own people have failed to recognize our gifts, our capabilities, and our identity. So what do you think we can do to shake loose, you know, that energy and that propensity to demonstrate prowess in the area of entrepreneurship?
On the big level, people have to quit focusing so intensely on negatives and on liabilities and on problems exclusively and look just as hard at assets and talents and skills and energy. what makes an entrepreneur ultimately is energy, risk-taking, and an idea and a willingness to get up if you've been knocked down. Mm-hmm. Not once, but 100 times, all right? And put in huge hours. Well, don't tell me that that set of characteristics isn't absolutely all over the place in any African-American community, because it is. And so it's really a matter of creating a realistic pathway and a doorway for all that talent to walk through the door in a manner that is workable, that they trust, and then proceed down a pathway that takes a long time and has failures in it, but has plenty of successes in it, and show, you know, first and foremost, all members of the African-American community that this is not only doable and possible, but it's common, and it's, you know, there's plenty of success stories right around them. And then highlight that growing group to the rest of the world to celebrate and to shop at. You need customers at the end of the day. And so, you know, I guess that'd be my thought.
You said a combination, though, of access and trust.
Right.
When you talked about access to capital, access is important, as important.
Of a word, right.
Yeah, understanding the access part is as important as understanding the capital. And you also mentioned trust. What do those things come in?
So trust is a two-way street, obviously, but I'm talking mostly about people in the communities trusting somebody enough, whether it's NDC or Silas's group or whoever, to avail themselves of at least step one, you know, and that as hard as step one may be, which is probably, you know, learning and writing a business plan and doing market research and, you know, really sharpening their idea as well as their skills, that they trust that these folks will be with them on step two, which is the financing. They need their family to trust. So that's the trust I'm talking about. And it's not going to come from big institutions. It comes from within the community, which is why community partnerships are critical throughout all of this conversation and implementation. But then access to capital, what that means is that our lending, like I said, $12 million to date to hundreds and hundreds of small businesses, that's primarily been what we call character-based lending. And that is to say that banks pretty much are forced to lend or want to lend based on other C's of lending, like how good is your credit score, how good is your collateral, how good is your capacity, they call it proven capacity. Well, our folks don't come with that, because if they did, they'd be at the bank. Mm-hmm. So what we get to know is their character through the training class, through the partnerships, through our interaction with them, and we base our lending decision very heavily on that, side by side with their business plan, because they're starting at Jump Street. And if a person has been diligent and has been, you know, open to ideas and advice, if they've been doing things they don't like to do, like learning about accounting, or whatever it may be, that's the character we're looking for, because there's a lot that happens in a business, we call it the back room, that isn't a whole lot of fun. Maybe it's at midnight at your dining room table doing your books. But that's the kind of character it takes, and so that's what we base our lending on, and that's the access I'm talking about.
And Silas, you, with the MASCA proposition, have operationalized this networking and providing support services from marketing to back room to sharing, actually, collaborating on ventures. Talk about that.
Well, you know, use an example of a project we're working on now in St. Paul, where we are working with the developer, which is a local nonprofit, Aurora St. Anthony. We're also partnering with NDC, which is a lender. So we started off with that developer and provided them a service of outreach and marketing for them to find diversity contractors to work on their project. We did pre-bid conferences and things of that nature, outreaching, making them aware of the project, breaking down the specs so that they could understand it. And then when some of them were interested in the project, we assisted them with doing their estimates, takeoff, so helped them negotiate. So then they got on the project, and then we went to NDC and MEDA, and they loaned them money to so that they could finance the project and do the project. And so those contractors have, you know, created 15 jobs on the project, got to do projects that was much larger in dollar value than what they had done before. Most of them are experiencing at least 100% growth in their income as a result of working on this project and working through this process. Mm-hmm. And so that's what MASCA provides. We take it to where all of those folks were out there, but when we came along, we made their relationship actually work, while before they were having a difficulty being able to make that connection because of a number of pain points that all of them have, that when MASCA comes in, we resolve that, and then we create an environment where there's work, there's capital, there's jobs being created, and then there's professional support so that we can consistently do that over and over.
I heard you use the term pain points, and you talked about pain points our businesses experience in growing and development, but we also operate in an environment that has created, I believe, structural barriers to our success, I think. And despite what Mike has just said about not focusing on the negative, you got to recognize what's out there. What barriers do you think small businesses discover that are not barriers that reflect their capacity, their ability, or their desire to do the work, perform the work, and deliver?
Man, I'd say I'd probably summarize the barrier as the inability to get over that whole trust issue, because when you bring in information that the person who's looking at it doesn't believe, then your ability to get anything out of them is just stops right there.
Let me be and real cynic here.
Okay.
I think sometimes the person that you're trying to sell your business to believes and knows but decides that he just doesn't want to do business with you because he's got cousin, friend, neighbor, or somebody else, and that's a change. What's working works for him, why should he change? And so that's a pain point, it seems to me. How do you get around that? Maybe there's some places you can't, but are there some places where you can get around that because there is an obligation, if that's a community-based organization or a government organization, or if it's a business that derives substantial revenue and patronage in your community? You are part of the success of that business, but you're not benefiting other than as a consumer. Is there something there that has to go into your consideration, as well as the things that you do to improve personal integrity and capacity of individual businesses? What do you think?
Yes, and we believe that the nonprofit community, especially the nonprofit developers, should be a major portion of the solution, because they have projects that they are doing that they got public money for. They have a commitment to the community. They say workforce development is their thing. And so, and they should not be bottom line driven. I mean, that shouldn't be, right? Making a profit should not be their thing, because they're a nonprofit. Creating opportunities and creating jobs should be the issue. So for us, if we had that relationship fully actualized, then the work that's needed to create the jobs it's all right there. We wouldn't need to go find a for-profit entity or go bid somewhere. We should be able to negotiate with those. So that is the number one barrier that we see, is that the people who are most friendly or should be most friendly to working in this kind of a model heretofore have been saying, prove to us that it worked, and they're like, well, it's new, how can we, if we don't get volume, it's gonna be, and so we've worked around that curve with partners such as NDC and MEDA, and are now looking to re-engage those nonprofit developers to become our partners over the long term so that we can begin to see some job creation take place.
Keillan, is there a strategy that involves reaching out to legacy institutions in the Black community? Even organizations like the Urban League, for example, or Hallie Q. Brown in St. Paul, or Sabathany, even organizations like Black fraternities, yes, and sororities, even organizations like Black churches. There's a lot of money in our community. Even though the statistics say, you know, that there's this huge disparity in income and wealth, that notwithstanding, a lot of money moves in this community. Everybody who's alive is buying groceries, mm-hmm, mm-hmm, is living somewhere, is paying for gasoline. And so even if you're poor, you're part of a huge and phenomenal stream of revenue. The problem is, how do we capture some of that revenue to develop our families, our businesses, our neighborhoods? So what are you doing and what are you thinking about how we mobilize and connect and engage the organizational power of our community around this issue?
Yeah, certainly. I think there's a few things I'd like to say. One, I think it takes professionals like myself, Silas, and everyone sitting at this table to engage other people, start that dialogue. I think with the nonprofit community, I've been in talks with several of them saying, how can you redirect your spending? Don't spend any more. Just redirect your spending to people who are in your community, who are of your community, and thinking about your community. So if you buy paper, you buy accounting service, you buy this, why not hook up with someone who's within the community? I'm not asking you to spend any additional money. I think it also comes with some of the legacy institutions saying, why don't we have classes on not only financial learning, but how do you cycle the dollar around in your community? How do we say that you may not like this community today, but what if there were more entrepreneurs who own the houses, who own the grocery store, who own the convenience store with the stale food, and they'd be responsible because they live in the community that you lived in. And so every time there's a complaint, you just walk down to that neighbor's house and say, hey, my kid bought some rotten fruit, you need to replace it. Mm-hmm. And so I think that starts with some of the legacy institutions saying, how do we come back and invest not just capital, but the knowledge? Because money is very important, but more than that, it's the know-how and the knowledge that we pass on from generation to generation. Because you can give someone $1 million and go broke the next year, but you pass on that wealth, they go broke, and they can figure out how to make that money again. So I think it's both going to some of the majority institutions saying, could you spend money with us to show that there's trust? Because sometimes in our community, we don't trust each other, and we need validation from a third party. And then within the legacy institutions of ours saying, hey, how do we transmit that knowledge to do business with each other?
Okay. Gentlemen, this has been a great conversation. I'm going to ask you for a parting comment. We're at the end of this segment. Thank you so much. I promised my viewers robust conversation. I think I've delivered once again. But I want you, Mike Temali, and Silas Houston, to make one final invitation to our viewers to avail themselves of the services you provide.
Well, we would love to hear from anybody that is in the viewership here in the community that has a idea for a business, an ambition for a business, to give us a call or look up our website, ndc-mn.org. And see if we have any resources that could help them achieve their dream, because by them achieving their dream, they're helping the whole community dramatically in multiple ways, and that's why we do this.
Same thing, make the offer if you would.
Well, that MASCA is operational. We provide services to general contractors, municipalities, diversity contractors, anyone who has a community slant that wants to see development come specifically within the African-American community, but the minority community overall. We are a for-profit entity, and we are looking for people to partner and invest with us. And if that's something that you're interested in, give me a call.
Well, there you have it. An hour goes so quickly. This has been a great conversation. Keillan Curtis, thank you. Silas Houston, MASCA, thank you. Mike Temali, NDC, thank you so much for what you do and for this program. I'm Al McFarland. This is Conversations with Al McFarland. We'll see you next time. Thank you.
Programming is supported by UCARE, where health coverage, personal service, and quality care come together to put members first. Learn more at ucare.org. UCARE, healthcare that starts with you.
Be up, be down, be clean, be messy, be here, be wherever, be sour, be sweet, be the rhythm, be the beat, be funny, be serious, be in, be out. Wherever you're at in life, be you. With Medica, you belong.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We got to say goodnight. We want to thank Al McFarlane for bringing us all those great words and all our lovely guests, all the guests in the house. Everything's good, you know. So I want y'all to tune in every Tuesday morning right around 9 o'clock. Because we're going to play a song. All the guests will be home. We'll be feeling like talking. Have a robust conversation. Because it's news is clear. Everybody knows we gotta keep it right clear. We just going to talk about the Al McFarlane Show.
Thank you.